From New York, this is Democracy Now!
First thing we have got to do, whether or not I'm president, is to shut this president up right now. Because he is undermining the doctors and the scientists who are trying to help the American people. It is unacceptable for him to be blabbering with unfactual information, which is confusing the general public.
We have to do testing. We have to get the testing kits up and ready. I would have the World Health Organization. I'd take advantage of the test kits they have available to us. Even though the president says a million or more are coming, let's just get all the tests we can done as quickly as we can.
Democratic presidential rivals Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders face off in their first one-on-one debate, this time amidst the coronavirus pandemic. In a D.C. studio with no live audience or handshakes, today we bring you excerpts of that debate on where they agreed and where they didn't.
Voted against the Defense of Marriage Act. You voted for it. I voted against the bankruptcy bill. You voted for it. I voted against the war in Iraq, which was also a tough vote. You voted for it. I voted against disastrous trade agreements like NAFTA and PNTR with China, which cost this country over 4 million good-paying jobs. You voted for it. I voted against the Hyde Amendment, which denies low-income women the right to get an abortion. You have consistently voted for it.
We'll get response from Princeton University professor Kianga Yamata Taylor of Princeton University. She's endorsed Bernie Sanders and Georgetown professor Michael Eric Dyson, who has backed Biden. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Today, an extended coronavirus global roundup. The coronavirus pandemic death toll has topped 6,500 deaths, with about 170,000 confirmed cases worldwide. At least 77,000 people have now recovered from the disease, though some reports suggest it has had lasting health impacts and that reinfection is possible. Sweeping measures are being rolled out across Europe, which is now considered the epicenter of COVID-19, the disease caused by the coronavirus. Italy remains on lockdown as it reported 368 new deaths Sunday, bringing its death toll to over 1,800. The Vatican announced it'll close Holy Week celebrations to the public. Spain is now also on lockdown in an attempt to slow down the coronavirus spread. Spain is now the second most cases of the disease in Europe after Italy, and the fifth highest number worldwide, with 8,000 infections and nearly 300 deaths as of Sunday. Video emerged of people in Spain cheering medical workers in the streets as the country prepared to shut down. Spanish Prime Minister Pedro Sanchez's wife has been diagnosed with COVID-19. Deputy Prime Minister Pablo Iglesias went into quarantine after his partner, also a minister, was diagnosed with COVID-19. Meanwhile, Ortega Smith and Santiago Abascal of the far-right Vox Party have tested positive. The party announced all lawmakers would work remotely. In France, the government ordered restaurants, bars and movie theaters shut down. Half the coronavirus patients in critical condition in France are under the age of 60. Austria's banned gatherings of more than five people, as well as set a curfew enforced by fines. Germany and Denmark are closing their borders. Meanwhile, in Britain, the government of Prime Minister Boris Johnson is under fire for limiting its recommendation to self-isolate to people over the age of 70. Britain's chief science advisor also suggested letting a certain number of people get infected to build, quote, herd immunity. But government officials backed away from the comments, saying it was not the official policy. Ireland has closed all pubs and bars days before St. Patrick's Day celebrations. In Iran, the death toll has topped 720, with nearly 14,000 confirmed cases. In the past 24 hours, at least 100 people have died in Iran. And officials said many of those who died were otherwise healthy. Around 15% of the fatalities were under 40 years of age. Lebanon is embarking on a two-week lockdown, closing its airport and borders and ordering people to stay in their homes. South Africa has declared a national disaster as COVID-19 takes a foothold on the African continent. Kenya said it was closing its border to all non-residents to curb the spread of the disease. At least 26 African countries are now reporting cases. In Latin America, Colombia and Panama are blocking entry for non-residents and citizens and requiring those re-entering the country to self-isolate for 2 weeks. Guatemala announced the first coronavirus death over the weekend. The 85-year-old man entered the country through Madrid last month. In mainland China, where the coronavirus first emerged but has steadily declined in recent days, 16 new cases and 14 new deaths were reported Sunday. There are now more confirmed infections outside mainland China than inside. China's offered to help countries, including Iran, Iraq, and Italy, deal with their outbreaks. Meanwhile, the youth climate strike, known as Fridays for Future, has moved to a digital strike. Swedish 17-year-old teen activist Greta Thunberg, who started the weekly strike, tweeted, quote, "School strike week 82. In a crisis, we change our behavior and adapt to the new circumstances for the greater good of society." Here in the United States, coronavirus cases have now topped 3,600, though the true number of cases remains unknown, expected to be thousands more due to extremely limited testing. The actual number, again, expected to be far higher. President Trump held a news conference Sunday.
Relax. We're doing great. It all will pass.
Relax. It all will pass, he said. Minutes later, at the same news conference, Anthony Fauci, director of the National Institute of Allergy, Infectious Diseases and top member of Trump's coronavirus task force, contradicted the president.
As I've said many times, and I'll repeat it, the worst is yet ahead for us.
President Trump had stepped out of the room at that point. Trump declared a national emergency Friday after intense backlash to his response to the pandemic and the devastating shortage of tests. A reporter asked Trump if he accepted responsibility for the lag in testing.
No, I don't take responsibility at all, because we were given a set of circumstances, and we were given rules, regulations, and specifications from a different time.
A reporter told NPR Trump did not push for testing earlier on because he wanted to keep the official case numbers low. During his remarks Friday, which Trump delivered in the Rose Garden, Trump repeatedly shook hands with officials and touched the microphone more than 30 times. In the early hours of Saturday, the House of Representatives passed an emergency coronavirus bill that was intended to help infected workers by mandating paid sick leave. But the bill only guarantees paid leave to around 20% of American workers. The bill does not apply to companies with 500 or more employees, and workplaces with fewer than 50 workers can request a hardship exemption. Meanwhile, the Los Angeles Times reports the Trump administration isn't allowing states to expand Medicaid during the coronavirus pandemic, as was done during other crises, such as after 9/11, Hurricane Katrina and the H1N1 or swine flu outbreak. The Trump administration proposed rules last summer that would loosen regulations around nursing homes, including doing away with the requirement that nursing homes employ at least one specialist in preventing infections. The coronavirus has killed 13 residents at the Kirkland Life Care Center in Washington state, and over a third of the workers have been found to have the infection. The White House said Saturday Trump has tested negative for COVID-19 after coming in contact with Brazilian President Jair Bolsonaro's press secretary, who was diagnosed with the illness. It's not clear what happened with Bolsonaro. Reports were he tested positive, then it was announced he tested negative. Miami Mayor Francis Suarez has tested positive for the coronavirus after meeting with Bolsonaro and his staffers. Bolsonaro's son said his father has tested negative after reports to the contrary. In Brazil, Bolsonaro defied recommendations for curbing the virus, greeting and encouraging rallies of pro-government supporters. As states ramp up measures to stem the spread of the virus, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has recommended canceling gatherings of more than 50 people for the next 8 weeks. At least 33 states have announced school closures of some kind. New York City and Los Angeles, the nation's two largest school districts, are shutting down classes starting today. New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio announced the closures Sunday after intense pressure from teachers, healthcare workers and concerned New Yorkers. De Blasio said it was possible schools might remain closed through the rest of the school year. 1.1 million New York City students and their families will be affected. New York now has the highest number of coronavirus cases in the country, with at least 730 infections and 6 deaths. New York Governor Andrew Cuomo said the state has some 3,000 intensive care unit beds, that's ICU beds, and that 80% are currently occupied. At least 7 states, including New York, Illinois, Massachusetts, and Ohio, are closing bars and restaurants to eat in business, but most will remain open for delivery or takeout for now. Major retail chains, including Walmart, Kroger, and Trader Joe's, are restricting shopping hours. Apple closed all its stores outside Greater China this weekend. Nike's also closing U.S. stores, and Disney is closing all hotels and retail stores. Whole Foods CEO John Mackey is under fire after he sent out an email to workers saying workers could donate accumulated paid time off to fellow workers with medical emergencies or a death in the family during the pandemic. In Los Angeles, all jury trials are reportedly being suspended, and all new criminal and civil trials are being put off for at least 30 days. The murder trial of real estate heir Robert Durst will be postponed. In Colorado, the state legislature has shut down. The Peace Corps is suspending its operations and evacuating its volunteers around the world. In media news, the Associated Press had to temporarily shut down its D.C. office after a staffer came into contact with a possible coronavirus patient. 6 CBS workers have tested positive for the coronavirus, and Vox closed its offices after a worker tested positive. The aviation industry has taken a major hit. American Airlines said it would cut international flights by 75% and U.S. flights by 20% through May. Delta Airlines announced a system-wide 40% capacity cut and plans to ground up to 300 planes. President Trump added the U.K. and Ireland to the coronavirus European travel ban into the United States over the weekend. People returning home from overseas in recent days were made to wait hours for medical screening tests at airports, in some cases in overcrowded spaces. Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker tweeted, quote, "The crowds and lines at O'Hare are unacceptable and need to be addressed immediately. Real Donald Trump, VP, since this is the only communication medium you pay attention to, you need to do something now. These crowds are waiting to get through customs, which is under federal jurisdiction." Pritzker added, "The federal government needs to get its bleep together now." Governor Pritzker said Sunday a Trump staffer called and yelled at him for the tweets. Meanwhile, 2 emergency room doctors, one in New Jersey, one in Washington State, are in critical condition, raising more fears for those delivering frontline services. The Chinese experience supports the fear that healthcare workers are at particularly high risk. In other medical news, scientists at Johns Hopkins Hospital are about to announce they're developing a treatment option involving blood serum from recovered patients, which could be just weeks away. In Puerto Rico, Governor Wanda Vasquez signed an executive order shutting down most businesses and imposing a 9 p.m. curfew on the island. Restaurants that offer delivery or takeout, pharmacies, gas stations and banks will be spared. In financial news, the Federal Reserve cut the interest rate to near zero, plunging Dow futures by 1,000 points Sunday, triggering a limit down, which prevents stocks from dropping further. The Fed also says it'll inject money into the markets by buying $700 billion in bonds. Trump congratulated the Fed on the move Sunday, saying it made him very happy. A federal judge has blocked a Trump rule that would have thrown 700,000 people off of food stamps, known as SNAP, or the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. The rule would have required affected recipients to work at least 20 hours a week in order to qualify for food stamps beyond the first 3 months. U.S. District Court Judge Beryl Howell wrote, quote, "As a global pandemic poses widespread health risks, guaranteeing that government officials at both the federal and state levels have the flexibility to address the nutritional needs of residents and ensure their well-being through programs like SNAP is essential, they wrote. In immigration news, New York City Congressmember Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez confronted an ICE agent at LaGuardia Airport who helped transport six immigrant children from Texas to New York amidst the pandemic. The congressmember intervened after immigrant rights group New Sanctuary Coalition sounded the alarm on the transportation of minors. Senator Bernie Sanders and former Vice President Joe Biden faced off in their first one-on-one debate Sunday. The debate took place in CNN's studio in Washington, D.C., with no live audience. It was originally scheduled to take place in Arizona ahead of the state's primary Tuesday, but was canceled due to the coronavirus pandemic. The candidates greeted each other with an elbow bump as they took the stage and sparred over health care, climate change, campaign funding, Social Security, their past voting records, and how best to fight pandemics like the coronavirus. CNN anchor Jake Tapper asked the candidates about whether a revolution was the best path forward for the country.
We have problems we have to solve now. Now, what's a revolution going to do? Disrupt everything in the meantime? Look, Bernie talks about, the senator talks about his Medicare for all. He still hasn't told you how he's going to ever get it passed. He hasn't told you how, in fact, there's any possibility of that happening. He hadn't told you how much it's going to cost. He hadn't told you how it's going to apply. It doesn't kick in for 4 years even after it passes. We want a revolution. Let's act now. Pass the Biden health care plan, which takes Obamacare, restores all the cuts made to it, subsidizes further, provides for lower drug prices, makes sure that there's no hidden bills, makes sure that we invest what I want to invest $50 billion in dealing with underlying diseases that are of great consequence, diabetes, Alzheimer's, and cancer. Make sure that we have a Medicare option that's in a public option providing Medicare for us. We can do that now. I can get that passed.
If you want to create an economy that works for all, not just the few, if you want to guarantee quality health care to all, not make $100 billion in profit for the health care industry, you know what you need? You need to take on Wall Street. You need to take on the drug companies and the insurance companies and the fossil fuel industry. You don't take campaign contributions from them. You take them on and create an economy that works for all.
Four states are set to vote Tuesday. Ohio, Arizona, Florida, and Illinois have all said they plan to go ahead with their primaries despite the pandemic. Louisiana and Georgia have postponed their state's primaries as part of efforts to combat the spread of coronavirus. Puerto Rico also said it plans to postpone its primary next month. In Arizona, officials in Maricopa County, by far the largest county in the state, making up over half of Arizona's population, announced over one-third of polling stations will be closed due to concerns related to COVID-19. We'll have more on last night's debate in the presidential primaries after headlines. In Iraq, rockets struck a base housing U.S. troops Saturday following U.S. airstrikes on Iranian-backed militia groups last week that Iraqi authorities say killed six people. The U.S. said the attacks last week were in retaliation for a rocket attack that killed two U.S. soldiers and a British Army medic 2 days earlier. President Barham Saleh warned such attacks from the U.S. could cause Iraq to descend into a failed state and hand power to the Islamic State. In Brazil, the two men accused of assassinating Rio de Janeiro council member activist Marielle Franco will face a jury trial. A Brazilian judge also decided former military police officers Ronnie Lessa and Elcio Queiroz will be tried for the killing of Franco's driver and the attempted killing of a former Franco aide who were in the car at the time of the ambush. In February, another one of the hitmen suspected of being involved was killed by police. Marielle Franco was assassinated just over 2 years ago. She was a vocal Black LGBTQ rights activist, longtime critic of police brutality. In New Zealand, as communities across the country mourn the first anniversary of the Christchurch Mosque massacre, a commemoration for the victims that was expected to draw large crowds was canceled over the weekend over fears of spreading the coronavirus. A smaller crowd still came together to sing and dance in honor of the 51 dead and dozens wounded. On March 15, 2019, a white supremacist terrorist attacked Muslim worshippers in two mosques during Friday prayers using an assault rifle. The suspect has since been charged with the murder of 51 people, 40 counts of attempted murder, and one terrorism charge. His trial is expected to start this summer. Amidst the national emergency over coronavirus, President Trump tweeted Sunday he's considering pardoning former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. So now it is reported that after destroying his life and the life of his wonderful family and many others also, the FBI, working in conjunction with the Justice Department, has lost the records of General Michael Flynn, Trump said. He went on, how convenient. I'm strongly considering a full pardon. It's unclear what records Trump was referring to. Flynn pleaded guilty to lying to the FBI during its investigation of Russian interference in the 2016 presidential campaign. And in Los Angeles, a group of unhoused mothers is trying to take over a vacant house and demanding the local government use all publicly owned vacant homes, libraries, recreation centers and other properties to house people immediately. This comes as the coronavirus is putting unhoused people and other vulnerable communities at a higher risk of infection. In January, another group of unhoused moms in the Bay Area, known as Moms for Housing, were given an offer to purchase the property in Oakland they occupied for months with their children. For our interviews with Oakland's Moms for Housing, go to democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The death toll from the coronavirus pandemic has topped 6,500, with at least 170,000 confirmed cases worldwide, and 77,000 people now recovering. In the United States, amidst an unprecedented national crisis with 3,600 reported COVID-19 cases, there are 61 deaths so far, 33 states closing schools and mass shutdowns in major cities, Los Angeles and New York City. Democratic presidential candidates Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders faced off in their first one-on-one debate Sunday night. They clashed on how to respond to the coronavirus pandemic, Medicare for All, the climate crisis, Joe Biden's record, and whether or not the U.S. needs a revolution. Practicing social distancing that would have been unimaginable even a week ago, the candidates did not shake hands. They touched elbows when they greeted each other. They stood 6 feet apart at the CNN Univision debate, which was held with no audience in Washington, D.C., instead of Phoenix, Arizona, due to concerns about the pandemic. In the course of the two-hour debate, Joe Biden promised his running mate would be a woman. Bernie Sanders said in all likelihood, so would his running mate be. Much of the night was dedicated to the coronavirus pandemic. The two also faced off on immigration, authoritarianism around the globe, and appealing to African-American and Latinx voters. They did not discuss the upcoming primaries in Arizona, Illinois, Florida, and Ohio this Tuesday, while elections will go on despite all four states having confirmed coronavirus cases. Georgia and Louisiana have already pushed back their primary dates due to the pandemic. Puerto Rico has also said it plans to postpone its primary to next month. We're turning now to two guests to respond to last night's debate and the situation we're in today. Kianga Yamata Taylor is with us, and Michael Eric Dyson joins us as well. Professor Kianga Yamata Taylor is Assistant Professor of African American Studies at Princeton University. She's the author of Race for Profit, How Banks and the Real Estate Industry Undermine Black Home Ownership, and From Black Lives Matter to Black Liberation. She's endorsed Senator Bernie Sanders for president. She just wrote a piece for the New York Times headlined, Why Sanders Isn't Winning Over Black Voters. And Michael Eric Dyson joins us. He is a Georgetown University professor, political analyst, and author. He endorsed Vice President Joe Biden for president. His books include Jay-Z, Made in America, and What Truth Sounds Like, RFK, James Baldwin, and our unfinished conversation about race in America. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! We originally scheduled you both for studios in Philadelphia as well as Washington, D.C., but you're both at home now because of this pandemic. I was wondering, before we even respond to the presidential debate last night, if you could just talk about your thoughts right now about yourselves, your family, and the community. Let's begin with Professor Michael Eric Dyson. And Professor Dyson, thanks so much for joining us and taking this time, speaking to us from your home.
Ms. Goodman, always great to be on with you. And, of course, with the equally brilliant Professor Taylor. Yeah, it is a devastating pandemic that we're confronting. There's no question that the besieging of our resources as a result of this pandemic has exposed flaws in our system, has forced us to not only socially distance ourselves from situations and circumstances that cause us harm, but also the reality is that we live in a culture where, you know, those who are least able to afford a sustained distancing of themselves from their workplaces face dire consequences. And as
Professor
an
Dyson, we're going to go back. We're going to go over to Kiangi Amata Taylor because we're having a little trouble hearing you, and we're going to fix that situation. Professor Kiangi Amata Taylor, you're talking to us from your home as well. Talk about the what we're facing today. I mean, we are certainly not in normal circumstances right now. In fact, I would venture to guess that the majority of people who are watching and listening to this broadcast or going to be reading it are now at home.
Yeah. Thanks, Amy, for having me on. I'm glad to be able to talk to you guys under these strange, surreal circumstances. I mean, this is completely unprecedented, that situation that is affecting every single person in this country, some more than others. I think, you know, for myself, my, you know, child's daycare ended on Friday for, you know, everyone's doing everything in two-week intervals. I think most of us know that the situation is going to get probably a lot worse before it gets better. This will not be resolved in the next 2 weeks. So we're dealing with that. I have a underlying respiratory condition, which means that I am being particularly mindful and alert and staying at home. And so, you know, my wife and I are both working from home, parenting our child, and
Princeton University is now online only?
Yeah, we have spring break this week, and then Princeton resumes next week. But, you know, it's administrations across the college, university administrations across the country had to improvise. And I think that we'll see how it works. I'm not sure how it's going to work. I just got an email from a student of mine this morning from Tokyo, who was, you know, in Princeton, New Jersey last week, and now is in Tokyo asking me how is he supposed to tune into the class. So these are unprecedented situations that we're going to have to try to figure out. But I think the main thing is that it really is pointing to the complete absurdity and dysfunctionality of entire aspects of our society that we have to begin to deal with in a serious way.
And Professor Michael Eric Dyson, I believe we have you back right now. We're going to go to break in just 1 minute. But if you could pick up where Kiangi Amata Taylor left off, disagree in your choice of presidential candidate in the Democratic Party, but overall the situation we're in right now with this growing pandemic.
No question about it. There is the reality is Professor Taylor said about the dysfunctionality and the absurdity of vast reaches of our public sector that have failed the fundamental you know, rights of citizens and put us at a greater risk. It has exposed gaping holes in the logic of supplying needs for those most vulnerable, shredding the safety net, and those who are most able to retreat into our wombs of protection. Reveal that there are economic disparities that need to be addressed, so that the healthcare crisis that has been revealed through the pandemic also reveals a crisis of capital, a crisis of conscience, and a crisis of provision for those who are the most vulnerable. There's no question about that. And our choice of different candidates here is a matter of strategy and pragmatism, not about the philosophical commitment to the reconstruction of American society along lines that would benefit the most vulnerable.
We're going to go to break, and then we'll be rejoined by our guests and play clips from the Democratic presidential primary that was held last night in a CNN studio instead of before a live audience with the candidates Bernie Sanders and Joe Biden standing 6 feet apart from each other for safety reasons in this coronavirus pandemic. Stay with us. That's quarantined Italian tenor Maurizio Marcini passionately singing, well, in English it translates, "None shall sleep," from his balcony in Florence, Italy, while Italy is under lockdown from the coronavirus. At the end of the song, his little boy jumps into his arms and put his hands on his ears, and his father stops singing. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're spending the hour discussing Sunday night's Democratic presidential debate. It took place in the studios of CNN in Washington, D.C., instead of in Phoenix, Arizona, before a live audience, because of the pandemic. At the beginning of the night, Senator Bernie Sanders and Vice President Joe Biden, after doing elbow bumps instead of handshakes, were asked about how they would respond to the coronavirus pandemic, and quickly began to debate Medicare for All. This is a part of their exchange, beginning with Joe Biden.
With all due respect to Medicare for All, you have a single-payer system in Italy. It doesn't work there. It has nothing to do with Medicare for All. That would not solve the problem at all. We can take care of that right now by making sure that no one has to pay for treatment, period, because of the crisis. No one has to pay for whatever drugs are needed, period, because of the crisis. No one has to pay for hospitalization because of the crisis, period. That is a national emergency, and that's how it's handled. It is not working in Italy right now, and they have a single-payer system. Well. Now, with regard to what else I would do, the fact is that we're in a position where I would bring together the leading experts in the world. Instead of doing this in the United States, instead of doing this piecemeal, sit down and do what we did before with the Ebola crisis. What is needed? And have one voice, like we did every day we met in that crisis in the Situation Room, laying out, so we lay out overall, for all the nation, what the best proposal is and how to move forward. In the absence of that, governors are making some sound decisions. They're doing the best they can by going out and getting the healthcare experts in their communities and their states to move. But it should be directed from the White House, from the Situation Room, laying out in detail like we did in the Ebola crisis, and we beat it.
Thank you. Senator Sanders, your response?
Well, first of all, the dysfunctionality of the current healthcare system is obviously apparent. As I said earlier, there are people who hesitate to go to the doctor. You're going to have a maze of regulations. Well, if this is my income, if that's my income, can I get it? Can I not get it? Clearly, we are not prepared, and Trump only exacerbates the crisis. When we spend twice as much per capita on healthcare as any other nation, one might expect that we would have enough doctors all over this country. One might expect that we would have affordable prescription drugs. One might expect that we are preparing effectively for a pandemic, that we were ready with the ventilators, with the ICUs, with the test kits that we need. We are not. And bottom line here is, in terms of Medicare for All, despite what the vice president is saying, what the experts tell us is that one of the reasons that we are unprepared and have been unprepared is we don't have a system. We got thousands of private insurance plans. That is not a system that is prepared to provide health care to all people. In a good year, without the epidemic, we're losing up to 60,000 people who die every year because they don't get to a doctor on time. And clearly this crisis is only making a bad situation worse.
That has nothing to do when you're in a national crisis. The national crisis says we're responding. It's all free. You don't have to pay for a thing. That has nothing to do with whether or not you have an insurance policy. This is a crisis. We're at war with the virus. We're at war with the virus. It has nothing to do with copays or anything. We just passed a law saying that you do not have to pay for any of this, period.
That's not true. As a matter of fact, that's not true. That law has enormous loopholes. I understand that Nancy Pelosi did her best. Republicans prevented it.
No,
what you're talking about, Joe, here is enormous loopholes within that, that in fact it is not necessarily covering treatment for all people in America, and that people are going to be stuck with a bill unless we change that. And we're going to offer legislation to, in fact, change that.
If I may, I offered legislation. I laid out on my plan that it would cover exactly what is not covered by the House. I laid out in the plan that I laid out for how we would deal with this crisis. Nobody will pay for anything having to do with the crisis. This is a national emergency. There isn't a question of whether or not this is something that could be covered by insurance or anything else. We, out of the Treasury, are going to pay for this. It's a national emergency.
So that's Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders. That's last night's debate. For more, we're continuing with Yemata Taylor, who is assistant professor of African American Studies at Princeton University, endorsed Bernie Sanders for president, and Michael Eric Dyson, Georgetown University professor, political analyst and author, has endorsed Vice President Joe Biden for president. Michael Eric Dyson, let's begin with you. If you could explain how you came to the decision to support Vice President Biden and his response on the issue of Medicare for All, which he said only recently, in the last few weeks, that he, if he was president, would veto if it came to his desk as president.
Yeah, well, look, I have great respect for both of these men who are battling it out, excuse me, for, you know, to become the Democratic nominee for the presidency of the United States of America. I came to my decision about Joe Biden because I thought he had the best and most effective methodology to deploy to become successful, to become president of the United States of America, to embody some of the progressive principles that I hold and that we hold in common. Obviously, nobody agrees completely with the person he or she selects as a nominee, but I think that Joe Biden possesses the ability to get elected, which is critical, then to work with vast numbers of people in consultation to make certain that the widest range of ideas are available under the, quote, big umbrella of the Democratic Party, and to forge connection and conversation with those people to get things done. Even on stage last night, when you saw Bernie Sanders and Biden, you know, exhibiting, in some cases, sharply contrasting methodologies, philosophies, and approaches to what they might do, the ultimate goal that they share in common, that something is wrong in America, that Trump's Trumpnopia, his hostility to the vulnerable, his indifference to those who are most likely to suffer, and his racist, sexist, xenophobic practices have to be defeated. And I think we have more in common in that sense than we do that divides us, though the gulf, the yawning abyss that divides us on some issues is undeniable. Mine is a very pragmatic and practical approach as a black progressive in America to suggest that Joe Biden possesses the electability, the foresight, the insight, and the ability to generate a consensus among vast numbers of African-American people. Now, we know that the black vote is not homogenous. We know that there's a heterogeneity to black interests, that older black Southerners may believe one thing, that black centrists have one thing in mind, that black progressives have another. But we can't stereotype. We know that there are younger people who are more moderate, and we know that there are older people like Auntie Maxine and, you know, Barbara Lee of California are progressive. They were woke before woke got awakened. So the reality is that there's a broad variety of constituencies constituted within Black America alone, and more broadly within the Democratic tent. And I think Joe Biden has the best possibility of articulating nuanced conceptions of philosophical ideas that a person like a Bernie Sanders would hold, that Bernie has pushed him, I think, in progressive fashion, but also invited Biden to articulate what it is about his own particular practices that would get him elected. So in that sense, I think I ride with Joe Biden because Joe Biden has the possibility of becoming president and enacting in real time the ideals, some of which he shares with Bernie Sanders.
Kianga Yamata Taylor, if you would respond, you are a Bernie Sanders supporter on both issues. Respond on the issue of Medicare for All, and also that Joe Biden recently said he would veto a Medicare for All bill that landed on his desk as president. But also, you did just write this piece in the New York Times, the op-ed piece, that says why Sanders isn't winning over Black voters.
Yeah, a couple of things. I came to support Sanders because I think that his politics and his political program actually capture the depth of the problem and crises in the United States right now. Even before the coronavirus hit the U.S., the problems with the grotesque amount of economic inequality in this country— the way that that manifests itself, particularly in Black communities in terms of underemployment, the issues with racial justice, injustice with the criminal justice system in this country, the issues with housing insecurity. The entirety of Bernie Sanders' program captures the abiding problems of inequality in the United States right now that have disproportionate impact in African-American communities. And so for me, this was not a difficult decision. I am, you know, someone who is deeply cynical about electoral politics and have been for some time. In many ways, I remain that way. But Sanders' candidacy in 2016, where someone who identifies as a socialist for the first time in a mainstream election garnered 13 million votes that I think spoke to the deep problems in this society and the deep desire to do something about them. But beyond the issue of the program, I think that of Sanders' program, I think that there are two things that are really important. His commitment to solidarity that is exemplified by his campaign slogan, us, not me, and the political revolution, which is really just about saying that is an understanding that in order to pass the kind of dramatic legislation that is necessary to transform the lives of people in this country, that it's not just going to come from Washington, D.C. It most likely won't come from Washington, D.C., but that it actually has to be pursued by social movements on the ground. It has to be pursued by organizing on the ground. And Bernie Sanders is clearly, by far and away, the only candidate that understands that. So when people talk about his political program as pie in the sky, as unrealistic, not only is that betraying their own cynicism, and for that matter, ignorance about the way that progress has been achieved in this country, but it dismisses what I think is very different and fundamental about how he sees the enactment of these policies, which is through broad social movements on the ground that have the ability to politically coerce a Congress that is filled with millionaires, that is filled with self-interested politicians who have very little interest, many of whom have very little, who have displayed very little interest in the conditions of the people who are worst off in this country. And I think now more than ever, we see the absolute necessity for universal health care in this country. That Joe Biden can show his face in public and talk still about affordable health care when we have a convergence of a public health care crisis and an economic crisis? And the solution to the public health care crisis is what will drive the economic crisis. Isolation, quarantining, putting the country on lockdown will exacerbate the economic crisis that is about to be unleashed in this country. So the notion that healthcare should be affordable, that prescriptions should be affordable in a time where people's ability to afford anything for ordinary working class people, their ability to afford anything will be thrown into absolute peril, makes no sense. And I think that what Sanders said over the weekend, that we are as safe as the least insured person, has never made more sense than it does in this moment. And so I think that the crisis that we are confronted with as a society right now not only highlights the vast inequality that is the underbelly of U.S. society that is usually and typically hidden. The lives of poor people are almost always papered over and hidden in this country. And in moments of crisis, they come bubbling to the surface. And so we have to ask as a society, are we going to use this opportunity, to use this moment to actually implement fundamental change? Or are we going to continue to kick this can down the road and acting as if there is some normal to get back to? This thing is going to forever alter the way that we interact with each other. It will forever alter probably life as we know it and have understood it to be in the United States.
We're going to break.
Means that we have to think about things fundamentally differently.
We're going to break and then come back to this discussion with Kianga Yamata-Taylor, Princeton University professor, has endorsed Bernie Sanders, speaking to us from her home in Philadelphia, as so many are now at their homes all over this country and around the world. In many cases, their countries are locked down. In other cases, they're in self-quarantine. In other cases, they're simply protecting themselves and their communities. Michael Eric Dyson, the same, speaking to us from his home, Georgetown University professor, endorsed Vice President Joe Biden. We'll be back with them in a minute.
You're concerned about my happiness, but all that thought you're giving me is conscience, I guess. If I were walking in your shoes, I wouldn't worry none. While you and your friends are worried about me, I'm having lots of fun. Counting flowers on the wall, that don't bother me at all. Playing solitaire till dawn with a deck of 51. Smoking cigarettes and watching Captain Kangaroo. Now don't tell me I've nothing to do. Last night I dressed in tails, pretended I was on the town. As long as I can dream, it's hard to slow the swinger down.
The Statler Brothers performing Flowers on the Wall. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. We're spending the hour discussing Sunday night's Democratic presidential debate in the midst of the pandemic and playing highlights of Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders. At one point, Joe Biden said if he wins the nomination, he'll pick a woman to be his vice president. Debate moderator CNN's Dana Bash asked Sanders if he would do the same. This is the exchange beginning with Biden.
If I'm elected president, my cabinet, my administration will look like the country. And I commit that I will, in fact, pick a woman to be vice president. There are a number of women who are qualified to be president tomorrow. I would pick a woman to be my vice president.
If I could just follow up. Just to be clear, you just committed here tonight that your running mate, if you get the nomination, will be a woman?
Yes.
Just to be clear. The vice president committed to picking a woman as his running mate. If you get the nomination, will you?
In all likelihood, I will. For me, it's not just nominating a woman. It is making sure that we have a progressive woman, and there are progressive women out there. So my very strong tendency is to move in that direction.
We are joined by Kianga Yamata-Taylor of Princeton University and Michael Eric Dyson of Georgetown. When you heard this, Kianga, What was your response?
I mean, it matters what the woman's politics are. Is Joe Biden picking Condoleezza Rice? You know, is he picking Kamala Harris? Is he picking, you know, a woman whose politics reflect his, which are, you know, based in the logic of market capitalism? So I think that Sanders gave a more honest answer, is that I think it, you know, it's important he's thinking about choosing a woman as a running mate, but that it actually matters what her politics would be.
And Michael Eric Dyson, your response to Joe Biden, the man you're supporting for president, saying he would absolutely choose a vice presidential running mate, a woman.
Yeah, I think this, ironically enough, given the brilliant genealogy given by Professor Taylor about the vast inequality that exists, the rising rates of unemployment, even in an ostensibly strong economy inherited from a previous administration that is now, whose coattails have been ridden by President Trump. When we look at, you know, fracking, when we look at health care, when we look at Medicare for all, when we look at the vast educational disparities that exist in this country and the degree to which the fundamental forces of inequality continue to punish those at the lower end of the totem pole. All that is true. But the reason Joe Biden can show his face, so to speak, is that Joe Biden has been trusted by the very people who have been the victims of white supremacy, social injustice, economic inequality in America. The irony is that the very people whose backs have been most against the wall, those among the most vulnerable citizens in this culture, vastly and by and large, seem to orient themselves toward a man who is capable of transmitting the ideals, the vision, the power, the energy for social revolution and transformation that Bernie Sanders has supplied, that he has certainly evoked, that he has stoked up in the masses of people who support him, that those people have contended that Joe Biden might be a greater vehicle. Now, when it comes to gender, how is this not the same business as usual that Professor Taylor spoke about? Joe Biden is giving an unequivocal break with the past. Only two women, Geraldine Ferraro in 84 and Hillary Clinton in 2016, have been on a national ticket, and of course, Sarah Palin in running with John McCain. So the reality is that in a sense, Bernie Sanders' inability to grapple with the existential dilemmas introduced by the scourge of identity politics has been one of the banes of his political existence. That at the end of the day, when the revolution he wants to imagine occurs, it seems to place an unrestricted embrace of an undifferentiated class above issues of gender and race and the like. And what ends up happening is that gender exacerbates class. Race exacerbates class. So, yes, you want to find a woman who is in ideological simpatico with you. There's no question about that. But why not presume? Why presume that only a man would fill that spot?
Well, let's put that question to Kiangi Amatatis.
Yeah, let me just very quickly say.
Just 1 sec. All right, okay. Professor Dyson, 10 seconds.
Yeah. All I'm saying is that the presumption that women won't automatically do that, that you'd automatically have a woman who will find ideological equivalence with you, is part of the problem of toxic masculinity and unconscious bias toward women. All people have to have that
question. Let's put that question to Professor Kianga Yamata-Taylor.
I mean, there are a couple of things. One is that the actual irony is that Joe Biden, who has spent his entire career up until this very moment, up until he was picked by Obama, manipulating white racial resentment, whether it's busing, whether it's the war on drugs, whether it's his authorship of the crime bill, whether it was his fervent support for Bill Clinton's welfare reform in 1996, is manipulating the racial resentments of white voters in order to curry favor with white suburban voters at the expense of African Americans. That has been the read on Joe Biden before Obama picked him. And in fact, you know, most people, you know, many people think that Biden actually picked or Obama actually picked Biden as a signal to those same voters that he wasn't as dangerous as the Republicans were making him out to be. So this kind of resurrected history of Joe Biden as the kind of, you know, mouthpiece for Black America actually makes no sense. We know that, you know, Joe Biden has no discernible policy that anyone can actually state. People, African-American voters in particular, those who have voted for Biden, I think, do so because of his former proximity to Barack Obama and due to questions about electability. I think politically, many African-American voters support Bernie Sanders' program. The story that was hidden in February because of the way that Michael Bloomberg crashed into the primary was the way in which Bernie Sanders' support among Black voters had dramatically increased, with one poll having him overtaken Joe Biden. A year ago, Joe Biden had a 30-point lead on Bernie Sanders among Black voters, and that had almost disappeared. And I think that for a variety of reasons that include the onset of the coronavirus as a thing in the United States, that included the consolidation of moderates around Joe Biden, and that unfortunately also included Elizabeth Warren for a week talking about how Bernie Sanders can't get anything done, all coalesced at the same time to raise this question of electability. But I think that's different from saying that Black voters have gravitated to Joe Biden because of his political program. No one knows what his actual political program is. It's almost impossible to find a single distinguishing policy that Joe Biden stands for. So there are all these other reasons that that have been attached to Biden that are, I think, explain his popularity among Black voters right now.
All right, Michael Eric Dyson, your response.
Yeah, I wouldn't dismiss the legitimacy of African-American voters as being done. I wouldn't undercut the ability of African-American people to make sophisticated distinctions and wise differences between candidates. This is a rearticulation of a logic that I think is especially pernicious. The doubt and skepticism about Black intelligence and the ability of Black prudence to be able to adjudicate competing claims about what's good and bad for Black America. This is a rearticulation of that in more sophisticated terms, but it undercuts the ability to believe that Black voters know what the hell they're doing. So that when Black people were assaulted, oh my God, they're orienting toward a centrist candidate who has no understanding of what the existential dilemmas have been of Black people, none of the political hurts and hardships that they've endured. To reduce Black people's support for Joe Biden to his proximity to Barack Obama is misled. Now, Professor Taylor's already laid out the fact that she thought that, or the argument was, that Obama was signaling to white resentment and the cast of white people.
We have 10 seconds.
Black progress that he was embracing him. You can't have it both ways. So you're undercutting Black voters either way. I think Black voters are intelligent. They're wise. They understand what it takes to win. And the Sanders idealism cannot truck with what Joe Biden has been able to do to convince that very constituency that he has their best interests at heart.
We're going to have to leave it there, but this is a discussion we want to continue, and we will certainly get you both back on. We hope in studio as this we deal, though, with this pandemic. We thank you both for spending this time from your homes. Michael Eric Dyson, Georgetown University professor, has endorsed Vice President Joe Biden, and we want to thank Kianga Yamata Taylor, professor of African American Studies at Princeton University. I'm Amy Goodman. This is Democracy Now! Thanks so much for joining us.